Cantar Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents 7 Steps to Managing Your Memory, What's Normal, What's Not, and What to Do About It, by Andrew E. Budson, M.D., and Maureen K. O'Connor, PsyD, narrated by Laural Merlington. Preface. You walk into a room to get something and forget why. You cannot think of the name of a friend at church, even though you have met her a half dozen times. You cannot remember as many details of important events of your life as your spouse, including those such as your wedding and family vacations. A week after seeing a movie, you have trouble remembering the name of the movie and parts of the plot. When you are driving and not paying attention, you take one or more wrong turns and end up somewhere you didn't intend to be. You cannot come back with the correct items from the store unless you write them down and look at the list. You spend too much time looking for your keys, glasses, wallet, or purse. You find yourself having difficulty finding your car in a parking lot. You find yourself looking at the calendar multiple times a day to remember your schedule. Your family tells you that you've asked that question before. Do some of these experiences sound familiar? Do you find it difficult to know which of these experiences are likely due to normal aging and which are likely due to a memory disorder? Do you sometimes have these or other memory problems? Do you joke that you have senior moments or suffer from CRS, frequently translated as can't remember stuff? Have you ever wondered or worried whether a slip of memory could indicate the start of Alzheimer's disease? Do you want to have your memory evaluated but are not sure how to go about it? Are you nervous about what the evaluation will consist of and what will and will not be covered by Medicare or other insurance? Would you be interested in taking a medication if it would actually improve your memory? Are you interested in helping your memory with healthy foods and diets, but confused by all the conflicting claims? Would you like to know whether doing crossword puzzles or playing computer games can improve your memory and stave off Alzheimer's disease? Do you want to start exercising to help your memory, but are not sure what is the right type or amount of exercise to do? Have you been diagnosed with mild cognitive impairment? Have you been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease? If you answered yes to any of these questions, this book was written for you. We can help you with your memory. We can explain which lapses of memory are normal and which are not. We can teach you diets and exercises that can help. We can provide you with strategies and activities to improve your memory and keep it strong. And we can help you know when you should see your doctor and what your doctor should do about your memory problems. In our practices as a neurologist and a neuropsychologist, we have evaluated several thousand individuals with concerns about their memories, just like you. We help them understand when their memory difficulties are due to normal aging, vitamin deficiencies, or depression, and when they are due to diseases such as Alzheimer's. Depending on the cause of the problem, we then recommend particular medications, vitamins, diets, exercises, or group activities, and sometimes even clinical trials of new medications being developed. So why now, and why this book? When we are discussing the results of these evaluations and our recommendations with individuals, we often wish that we had more time. More time to explain our rationale as to why their memory problems are likely due to normal aging versus a serious disorder. More time to explain how and why a medication works. And more time to explain the pros and cons of various treatments and recommendations. This book provides us with the opportunity to tell you all of the information about these and other topics, from which you can take in as little or as much detail as you would like. Although you may feel worried about having memory problems, today there is more we can do to diagnose and treat memory problems than ever before. In just the last few years, there has been an explosion of new diagnostic tests and criteria to help evaluate memory loss, as well as a huge expansion in our knowledge of treatments, diets, and exercises to help memory in individuals aging normally, as well as in those with mild cognitive impairment, dementia, and Alzheimer's disease. Yes, we can even help those diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. This book is our opportunity to share these advances with you and help you manage your memory in 7 basic steps. How to use this book. We set out to write this book to be as useful to as many people as possible. If you are an older individual with concerns about your memory, this book was written with you in mind. We suggest that you listen to the book cover to cover. A family member or friend of someone whom you are concerned about, this book was also written for you. We suggest that you listen to the book cover to cover as well. An older individual without any memory problems or concerns, but with a desire to strengthen your memory. We suggest that you listen to steps 1, 2, 5, and 6. Other steps can be heard if you wish. An individual of any age who wishes to learn more about memory, including late-life memory disorders, their treatments, and the diets, exercise, and strategies that can help, please listen to any steps you wish. A healthcare professional, this book can be recommended to your patients to help them better understand memory, memory disorders, their treatments, and the diets, exercise, and strategies that they can do to manage their memory. An educator, this book can be used as an easy-to-hear text on memory and memory disorders, full of case examples. A student who hopes to use this book to improve their performance on exams. This is not the right book for you. We would suggest Make It Stick by Brown, Rodiger, and McDaniel. About the stories. To make this book more accessible, we have woven stories throughout the text. As we mentioned later, we hope that these stories will make it easier to understand the issues we are discussing and their implications. If, however, you would prefer to hear the text without the stories, please do so. You can skip them altogether, or you can hear specific stories when you want more information on a particular topic. We've written the book so that the stories are optional. To make it easier to jump into the stories in the middle, we've included the cast of characters here. Sue, an 80-year-old woman with concerns about her memory. John, Sue's husband. Jack, a 72-year-old man with concerns about his memory. Sarah, Jack's daughter. Sam, a mutual friend of both Sue and Jack. Sam's wife, Mary, has Alzheimer's disease. Introduction. That could have been embarrassing, Sue thinks to herself. She was halfway through lunch with one of her closest friends before the name of her friend's husband came to her. How could I have forgotten? She thinks again. She is able to remember everything about him, what he looked like, his career as a surgeon, his retirement party, except his name. Sue was able to cover for this little memory lapse. In fact, she has become quite good at covering for memory lapses, such as trouble coming up with someone's name and laughing it off when the lapse was noticed. Sue herself, however, isn't laughing. Sue is worried about her memory. Worried, in fact, is a bit of an understatement. She is absolutely terrified that she is developing Alzheimer's disease. She just turned 80. The same age that one of her friends, Mary, was diagnosed with this disease. Since that time, Mary has had to move out of her apartment and into a facility. Sue hasn't mentioned her concerns to her friends or her children. Her children would only worry and overreact, wanting her to go into one of those retirement communities. She doesn't need that. After all, she has no difficulty living in her home. She does her own shopping, cooking, cleaning, and she has never been late with a bill payment. Her friends wouldn't be interested in hearing about her concerns. It would only make them anxious about their own similar memory difficulties, or worse. They would start to treat her like an invalid and stop including her in their social activities. She has mentioned her concerns to her husband, John. He doesn't think her memory is abnormal, and she doesn't want to worry him by bringing it up again. Sue thinks about some of her other memory lapses. Just yesterday, she walked downstairs to the basement and could not remember for the life of her what she was looking for. It was only when she walked back up to the kitchen that she remembered the roll of paper towels that she needed, which she then successfully walked down to get. She doesn't have trouble remembering things that happened yesterday or last week, but she finds it quite difficult to recall some of the things from her childhood, such as the name of her best friend in second grade. Is that normal? Sue isn't sure. Sue is having trouble remembering names, walking into a room and not knowing why she is there, and recalling some of the information from her childhood. Yet she is completely independent with everything she does in life, and she wants to stay that way. She is quite concerned about her memory. Should Sue be worried? Let's consider another story. Jack has just come from his local community lodge where Sam, one of his buddies, suggested that Jack get his memory checked out because Sam thought Jack could be developing Alzheimer's disease or dementia. Could he be right? Jack thinks about Sam's words. He isn't sure whether he should thank Sam or slug him. Part of him wants to do both. Deep down, he knows that Sam is trying to be helpful, but he has a lot of nerve. Sure, Jack knows he has some trouble remembering, but who his age doesn't? Just because Sam's wife has dementia, all of a sudden he thinks he's a goddamn doctor. Not that the doctors know very much about memory problems, from what Jack could tell. Sam had to take Mary to her doctor 4 times before the doctor actually did anything about it. Jack considers his memory. He didn't think anything was wrong, at least not any more than with anyone his age. He is 72, after all. Sure, his memory isn't as good as when he was 32, or 62, for that matter. At least half his friends, maybe 3/4 of them, have similar difficulties coming up with people's names and remembering the details of what they did yesterday, or were going to do the next day. The more he thinks about it, the more he thinks his memory is probably normal. Better than normal, in fact. How many people his age can list off their buddies from high school and the make, model, and year of the cars that they drove? Heck, he can even remember some of his friends from grade school. Jack appreciates that he doesn't know very much about dementia or Alzheimer's disease, but he'd bet that few people his age can remember details of their childhood like he could. Still, Jack feels unsettled. Sam stressed that the reason he was bringing it up was because there were medications Jack could take that would improve his memory. He doesn't want to be stupid. He had seen his neighbor ignore his high blood pressure and then suffer a stroke that left him unable to talk. Sticking his head in the sand is definitely not the right thing to do. After all, he has never been one to run away from a problem. He'd rather stand and confront it. Perhaps he should call his doctor. Do the stories of Sue or Jack sound familiar? We will be following Sue and Jack throughout this book to illustrate the 7 steps to managing your memory. We will be with them as they gain a better understanding of normal memory, step 1, and partnering with their doctor, get a thorough evaluation, step 2. We'll watch as various disorders are considered and a diagnosis is made. Step 3. We will hear about the medications they are prescribed. Step 4. The diets, vitamins, and exercise regimes they explore. Step 5. And the habits, strategies, and aids they use to improve their memories. Step 6. We'll also hear them struggle with issues of mood, anxiety, and adjustments in their lives that need to be made. Finally, we'll hear where they turn for additional resources and how they plan their future. Step 7. We hope that these stories, composites of real people we have worked with, will make it easier to understand the issues we are discussing and their implications. We've written the book so that the stories are optional. Without further ado, we now go to step 1 to understand normal memory and the changes in thinking and memory associated with healthy aging. Step 1. Learn what is normal memory. Is your memory normal? To answer that question, we need to start with a different question. What is normal memory? In step 1, we will learn about the problems that are part of normal memory. One thing that makes memory loss tricky, however, is that the difference between normal and abnormal memory isn't necessarily the type of problems that occur, but rather the frequency and severity of those problems. Nonetheless, in order for us to begin to help you know if your memory is normal or not, we need to first tell you about the memory errors that can happen to anyone of any age, and then let you know what changes occur to memory as we get older. 1. Which memory errors can happen to anyone of any age? In this chapter, we will examine a number of different ways that memory often fails in healthy individuals of any age, leading to forgetting or even distorted and false memories. We'll also begin to explain how memories are formed, stored, and retrieved. Memories fill up the pages of our lives. Sue, whom we met in the introduction, and her husband John are visiting Washington, D.C. for the first time since they took their children there about 40 years ago. They are excited to see which parts of the city have remained the same and which have changed. Although she hasn't mentioned it to John, Sue is also using this visit to test her memory, to see what she can and cannot remember of their prior visit. They are eating lunch at the Garden Cafe in the National Gallery of Art. When we speak about memory, in general, we are referring to memory for the episodes of our lives. Think about an episode of your life, such as the last lunch you had with a friend. The episode would include the sights of the restaurant and your friend, the sound of your friend's voice, the smells and tastes of the foods, as well as your thoughts and feelings at that time. When you are creating a memory, the information from your senses, thoughts, and emotions becomes drawn together in a coherent story, just as if you were writing it down. Each separate sensation, say the sound of your friend's voice, would constitute an aspect of the memory. The different aspects would come together to represent the several parts of the episode. For example, one part could be your impressions of the waiter, what he looked like, including his clothing, haircut, mannerisms, and voice. Another part would be what drink you ordered, whether a glass of water, diet soda, or a cocktail with a little umbrella in it. There would be a part for your lunch entree and a part for what your friend ordered. There would be parts for your conversation, different parts for each topic you discussed. The hippocampus binds the memory together. When the episode is over, in this case, when your lunch is over, the different aspects of each part of the event and the different parts themselves become bound together as a coherent whole, a memory. Once the episode is bound, it can then be stored so you can later retrieve it as a whole. In fact, once bound together, Thinking about any part of the memory, such as your entree, or even the smell of your entree, can bring the entire episode to mind. The binding is coordinated by the hippocampus, the memory center of your brain. There's one on each side, left and right. They are located deep inside your brain on the inside and bottom of each temporal lobe, which are next to your temples on each side of your head, just behind your eyes. The left hippocampus is somewhat specialized for remembering verbal and factual information, and the right for nonverbal and emotional information. Memories fade with time. After lunch, Sue and John walk across the grassy National Mall to visit the National Air and Space Museum. "I'm really looking forward to seeing what the Air and Space Museum looks like now, compared to how it was when we were here with the kids," John says, as his shoes crunch along the gravel path. "Are you sure that we visited this museum?" asks Sue. "I don't recall having been to it before." "Yes, I'm absolutely sure. I have a vivid memory of it because we were here on the bicentennial, 1976, and it had just opened. You know how interested I was in space then." "I know we were here in D.C. on the bicentennial. I just don't recall going inside the Air and Space Museum." They walk through the door of the museum, enjoying the cool air inside. Sue looks up and sees the Spirit of St. Louis, the lunar module, and several other air and space craft. She is not quite sure that John is right, that she has been in the museum before. She can recall vividly how it felt to be standing under the Spirit of St. Louis 40 years ago. "John," she says, "you're absolutely right. I now remember being here and seeing these hanging planes and spaceships." Sue pales slightly as she thinks about having forgotten that she was in this museum before. Memory is transient. Things we remember don't tend to stick around forever. There is a gradient in which events that occurred recently are relatively easier to remember than events that occurred in the more distant past. There are many myths about memory, and one of them is that we are supposed to remember everything that ever happened to us, particularly if it was notable, even if it happened long ago. Thus, you may worry if you cannot remember details of that notable vacation you took to Great Britain 20 years ago. However, not remembering details of a vacation from many years ago may be perfectly normal, particularly if you haven't thought about that vacation much over the years. When you think about a memory, it is as if you are re-experiencing and then restoring the memory again, so it stays fresh and easy to recall. But a memory that doesn't get thought about at all will fade with time. How quickly will it fade? It depends on how strongly the memory is formed in the first place. The more unusual the episode, such as meeting the Queen of England, the stronger the memory will be and the longer it will take for the memory to fade. In later chapters, we'll consider other factors that also help determine how strong a memory is when it is formed. Now let's turn to one of the most common reasons that memories fail. You need to pay attention to form a memory. After spending several hours enjoying the Air and Space Museum, Sue and John stroll west along the gravel path of the mall, past some of the other Smithsonian buildings. Finally, they reach their destination, the World War II Memorial, which is new since they were last here. "Hey, Sue, listen to this," John says as he reads from a plaque. "Freedom Wall holds 4,048 gold stars. Each gold star represents 100 American service personnel who died or remain missing in the war. The 405,399,000 American dead and missing from World War II are second only to the loss of more than 620,000 Americans during our Civil War. Sue isn't really listening. She has noticed a family that reminds her of their family when they were younger. The father, trying to teach the children some history. The girl, hanging on every word. The older boy, interested, but trying not to look too interested, because he needs to look cool. The mother, trying to keep the younger boy from making a run for it. They continue exploring the monument, making a slow loop around its large grounds. When they have explored for about a quarter of an hour, Sue notices a wall filled with brass stars. "What do you think?" she asks John. "Are these stars just here for decoration, or do you think that they mean something?" "I read you the explanation about 15 minutes ago."
"You did?" Sue asks with surprise.
"Yes. Each star represents 100 American servicemen and women who died or went missing in the war."
"Oh. Okay, thanks. I must have forgotten."
"Oh, no. Not another thing I am forgetting," Sue thinks to herself as she feels another wave of anxiety flooding through her. Not paying enough attention is the number one reason that healthy individuals experience difficulty remembering names, events, and that thing you went into the other room to get. Life is busy. We are often doing two things at once. If you are doing one thing, say, responding to an email, and someone interrupts you to ask you to do a few things, it wouldn't be surprising that you might forget one of the things you were asked to do. The reason is that your attention was focused on your email and not on the person who interrupted you and the things you were asked to do. This situation is an example of not paying attention, causing a failure to learn new information. Thus, when you are introduced to someone and then 30 seconds later, while still talking to him, you cannot remember his name. The problem is caused by the fact that you were not paying enough attention to his name. You were probably busy trying to listen to what he was saying or thinking of what you could say next. Now let's turn to the second type of not paying attention, that which occurs when retrieving a memory. You need to pay attention to retrieve a memory. After their time at the World War II Memorial, John flags down a cab, and he and Sue climb in. John gives the driver the name of their hotel in Georgetown, and the cab begins moving. It is election season, and everyone is talking politics.
"Where are you from?"
asks the driver. Sue tells him and asks, "Is everyone in this city obsessed with politics?"
"Yes, absolutely," he responds, "especially when there's an election coming up."
The three of them continue to chat about politics and the impending election.
"Excuse me," John says urgently to the driver, "but are you sure this is the way to Georgetown?" "You're absolutely right, sir," the driver responds as he turns off the meter. "You got me talking politics, and I started driving to the airport automatically without thinking about it," he says apologetically as he turns the car around. When we are carrying out actions automatically and our attention is focused elsewhere, we may not pay enough attention to a memory we are retrieving. Driving on autopilot and ending up in the wrong place is common and just one example of what happens when we are preoccupied and not focusing our attention on the information we should be retrieving. In this case, information related to where we are supposed to be going. We can now explain one of the most common failures of memory. When you walk into a room to get something but cannot remember why. What typically happens is that when we walk in to get a particular item, we often see something else that triggers a new and different thought, and we become distracted, lose the focus of our attention, and then cannot remember what we walked in to get. Here we are suffering from not paying enough attention. For example, let's say that we are going from the kitchen to the basement to get a screwdriver to tighten a knob on a cabinet door. We walk down the basement stairs, see the washing machine right in front of us, and remember that we need to finish doing the laundry. This simple thought of remembering that we need to move the clothes from the washer to the dryer distracts us sufficiently so that we temporarily forget about the screwdriver. And now we cannot recall what we went downstairs to get. When we give up trying to remember why we went downstairs and walk back up to the kitchen, we see the open cabinet door in front of us, remember that we need to get the screwdriver, and this time successfully go down to get it. Let's examine another common memory difficulty. Sometimes a name is on the tip of your tongue. "So who are you going to vote for?" asked the driver, now heading for Georgetown. "I'm going to vote for Governor Jones," John responds. "And what about you, ma'am? Are you voting for Jones, too?" "Me? No, I'm voting for Senator... Sue says, struggling to bring up the senator's name. "You mean Senator Smith?" asked the driver. "Yeah, he's got my vote, too. Least bad of the bunch, in my opinion." Have you ever been at a party and seen someone you know approaching you from across the room but cannot remember her name? You may remember many things about her. She lives in your town, has a son and a daughter, works at the school, and plays golf. But you can't remember her name, even though you know it, and you can almost feel it on the tip of your tongue. Good news. It's completely normal. Having a name on the tip of your tongue is the most common example of blocking, not being able to retrieve information from your memory, even when it is in there. Sometimes blocking a name occurs because you keep thinking of a similar but incorrect name. The incorrect name is blocking the right one. That's why if you stop trying to retrieve the name and think about something else for a while, the correct name may pop into mind. Thus far, we have examined how memories fail when we are trying to store or retrieve information. Let's now turn to how memories can become mixed up, distorted, and outright false. Suggested information can be turned into false memories. The next day, Sue and John are planning to visit the Lincoln Memorial. "I'm really excited to see it," Sue says as they are getting dressed in the hotel. "I know I've seen the Lincoln Memorial on TV and from a distance, like yesterday, but I don't think I've ever been to it up close, in person. I know it is supposed to be impressive." "Sue," John begins, "we definitely saw it with the kids on that first trip. I'm absolutely sure about it. I remember trying to keep their attention long enough to read them the Gettysburg Address from the wall before they started running all over the place. I think I got about halfway through before I gave up. Everyone's kids were running around, and it was a losing battle." "Hmm," Sue thinks to herself. "Maybe I have been there before. I didn't think I was at the Air and Space Museum either. But John was right about that." She thinks about it more, trying to imagine it, trying to put herself at the memorial. She pictures the white marble walls, colored with age, the children running around, John trying to read the words and teach them something, as he always does. She can start to see herself there, walking slowly up the steps, trying to keep track of the children. She thinks, "Maybe I have been there before." Sue continues to think about the Lincoln Memorial as they climb into the cab. The more she thinks about it, the more she believes that she has been there before. The scene becomes more vivid, and she pictures the location of the wall with the Gettysburg Address, John, their children, and the great seated statue of the man himself. She can picture herself reaching up and putting her small hand on the massive hand of the statue of Lincoln. "You know, John," Sue begins, "I'm sure you are right, that I did see the Lincoln Memorial with you and the kids." "Just wait till you're in front of it," John says. "I'm sure the memories will come back to you." The cab lets them off, and they walk to the steps of the memorial. Sue walks up the steps, waiting for the memories to come back to her. She reaches the floor level and begins to walk across to the seated statue. "Something is wrong. This view doesn't match my memory," she says to herself. She continues to walk slowly around the floor of the memorial. She then goes right up to the statue and looks with surprise how large and high it is. "I could never have touched the hand of the statue." "John," she says aloud, "now that I am here, I'm quite sure that I have never been here before. The picture I envisioned in my mind is completely different from how it actually looks."
"Really?"
"Yes. Do you think you could have been here without me?"
"You know, now that I think about it, I don't actually remember you here. Maybe that's why it was so hard to keep the kids under control, because you weren't around to corral them," he says, chuckling.
Think about an attorney questioning a witness by asking leading questions. Compare an open-ended request, such as, "Describe what happened when you were at the bank," to a leading question, such as, "Describe what happened when the defendant stormed into the bank, brandished a revolver, and asked the teller for money." These suggestions in the leading question make it more likely that the witness will actually remember the defendant storming into the bank, brandishing a revolver, and asking the teller for money. False memories, even highly elaborate and detailed ones, can occur in individuals with normal memory. In day-to-day life, this type of suggestibility occurs in more mundane but often important settings. Asking individuals if they took their medications in a leading way may make them think that they took them when they didn't. When we ask the question, "You took your pills this morning with your breakfast, right?" we are asking the individual to look inside and see if that memory is there. If just a part of the memory is there, for example, eating breakfast, the suggestion that he also took his pills may be all that is needed for him to falsely remember that he took his pills, when in actuality, he did not. Memories can become distorted, mixed up, or confused. That night, Sue and John are eating dinner at an elegant French restaurant. Classical music is playing in the background. "I love this piece by Bach," Sue says. "I think I played this concerto in high school."
"I like Bach too," John agrees.
"But are you sure that this piece is by Bach? I thought this was Handel."
"No, I'm sure it's Bach."
Just then the restaurant manager comes by their table.
"How is everything with your dinner this evening?"
"Wonderful," John responds.
"What piece of music is playing?" Sue asks.
"This is Handel's Water Music. Do you like it?" asks the manager.
"Very much, thanks," Sue responds.
After the manager departs, Sue says,
"Oh, John, I don't know what's going on with my memory lately. I really thought that piece was by Bach."
We generally expect that when we retrieve a memory, it will be accurate. It turns out, however, that memories are frequently distorted, mixed up with other memories, or otherwise confused. Have you ever thought that one of your friends told you something, but later realized that the information was from a different friend? Mixing up elements of memories is extremely common. One common example of this type of confusion is when you clearly remember that you locked the front door of your house in the morning, but when you return from your errands, you find, to your surprise, it is unlocked. The usual cause of this type of memory mix-up is that you were remembering locking it on another day. Memories of anything that we do frequently can easily be misattributed to the wrong time. Another frequent example is when you think that an idea is your own creation, but you actually learned the idea from a book you had read. Or perhaps you thought about doing something and then later believed that you actually did it, such as sending an email. We'll finish our examination of the ways that memory can fail in individuals of any age with two other ways that memories can become distorted. We tend to remember the past the way we view the present. A few days later, and Sue and John are back at home. Sue is in the family room. John walks in saying, "Hey, Sue, look what I found." He's holding up an old photo album. "Our pictures from Washington, D.C. on that trip with the kids." Sue and John begin to look at the old photographs. "I can't believe that people used to wear those polyester pants suits. No one looked good in those," Sue says.
"Fashions come and go," John remarks.
"Well, I'm glad that I never owned such clothes. You wouldn't have caught me dead in one of those pants suits." The next group of pictures are from the Air and Space Museum. There are many pictures of planes and spaceships.
"Hey, here's one of you," John says. "I knew you were in the Air and Space Museum with us."
"Yes, you were definitely right about that." Sue isn't thinking about being in the museum. She is looking at what she was wearing.
"John, let me see the album a minute,"
Sue says as she moves the photo album onto her lap. She flips through page after page. There is no doubt about it. 1, 2, and 3. She was wearing 3 different polyester pants suits during their trip to D.C. Just then, John notices what Sue is looking at.
"Hey, you used to wear those pants suits, too," he remarks.
"Yes, well, I guess we are all caught up in the fashions of our time," Sue says as she thinks to herself with a sinking feeling. "Another thing I didn't remember." We all have a tendency to have a coherent image of ourselves over time. So although we might say, "I was more liberal in my youth until I learned more about how the world really worked," in general, our picture of ourselves and the views we have held in adulthood is more of a stable, unchanging image than a movie showing the evolution of our views over time. In other words, we tend to remember our own attitudes and viewpoints from the past through the lens of the present. These effects tend to be strongest for feelings, emotions, likes, and dislikes. Thus, although we might be unlikely to misremember major factual details of a trip to the Middle East, our memories of how happy we thought the people were may be colored by whether there is turmoil or peace in the Middle East today. Another common example is how we view another person. Let's think of a colleague at work that we have known for a long time. When we are getting along with him quite well, we may feel that he has always been a great person, and we remember the times he helped us and his important accomplishments. However, our very memory of him can change quickly if, later on, we find ourselves at odds with him. Now, when we think of him, we recall all the mistakes he has made and the problems he has caused. When we retrieve a memory, we may accidentally change it permanently.
Earlier in this chapter, we mentioned that whenever we retrieve an old memory, it is as if we are re-experiencing and then restoring the memory again, so it stays fresh and easy to recall. Although this re-experiencing and then restoring has the advantage of strengthening the old memory so that it can be more easily retrieved, the disadvantage is that if there are specific parts or aspects of the memory that are, for whatever reason, recalled incorrectly, those incorrect aspects will be stored and become part of the memory. At a later time when we retrieve the memory, it is likely we will recall the memory with the incorrect information now incorporated into it. Say we watched a movie, perhaps The Godfather, with some friends from work. Later, we see the movie again with our spouse. A few years go by, and someone asks us if we have seen The Godfather. When we recall the memory, we begin to confuse the two times that we have seen the movie together. The next time someone asks us if we have seen The Godfather, we think back and respond, "Yes, I saw it with some friends at work, and I think my spouse was there too." Again, rewriting the memory. Finally, another year goes by, and someone asks us if we have ever seen The Godfather. And we respond with confidence, "Yes, I saw it at our house with my spouse and some friends from work." Summary. Memories for episodes of our lives are bound together by the memory center of the brain, the hippocampus. Memories fade with time, but can be strengthened when they are retrieved. Attention is important when forming and retrieving memories. Lastly, memories can easily become mixed up and distorted over time. Now that we understand these ways in which memory can fail in anyone, let's review some common memory complaints, including some of those we encountered in the preface and introduction, and see which aspect of normal memory explains them. You walk into a room to get something and forget why. This symptom is a common normal phenomenon. Not paying enough attention because you become distracted by something you see in the room is typically the cause. You cannot think of the name of a friend at church, even though you have met her a half dozen times. Blocking, when you cannot recall something you know on the tip of your tongue, is a frequent phenomenon. It can be entirely normal, particularly for names of people and other proper nouns. You cannot remember as many details of important events of your life as your spouse, including those such as your wedding and family vacations. The fact that memories become less accessible over time is a normal part of memory. Whether the forgetting of a specific event is normal or not, however, depends on many factors, including how long ago the event occurred, how important it was to you, and how often, if ever, you thought about it. When you are driving and not paying attention, you take one or more wrong turns and end up somewhere you didn't intend to be. Driving on automatic pilot and accidentally driving toward where you usually go, work, home, school, etc., is very common and due to not paying enough attention. You can remember the activities that your grandchildren are doing, but you mix them up, thinking that your grandson is playing baseball and your granddaughter is taking karate, when it is actually the other way around. Attributing real memories to an incorrect time, place, or person is the most common cause of mixing up memories like these, and it can be perfectly normal. You are quite sure that you never liked Richard Nixon until your spouse finds your old campaign buttons and sign-up sheets in the attic. And then you recall you actually went door to door to sign up voters to get Nixon on the ballot during his first Senate campaign. Here is a clear example of how your present knowledge, beliefs, and feelings about Nixon changed your memory of how you felt about him in the past. Your partner asks if you left the iron on before you left the house, and although you initially thought you turned it off, the more you think about it, the more you think he is right and you left it on. You turn the car around and drive home, only to find that the iron was off all along. Incorporating suggested information provided by others into your own recollections frequently occurs with leading questions. It is a common cause of false and distorted memory. You are at a cocktail party when you notice your zipper is broken. Just then, the host of the party introduces you to four people you haven't met before. As you continue chatting with them, you realize that you cannot recall any of their names. Here is another common and completely normal example of forgetting due to not paying attention when forming a memory. Because your attention was partly focused on your zipper, you didn't have enough attention remaining to learn their names. You run into an old friend you haven't seen for many years. You ask her if she is still working at the local bookstore and whether online sales have hurt their business. After staring at you with a confused look on her face, she gently reminds you that it is not she but your mutual friend who works at the bookstore. Although a bit embarrassing, this error is a fairly common and benign example of mixing up memories. Because they are friends, you are more likely to mix up elements of their lives than if there was no connection between them. By now, we hope that you are breathing a sigh or two of relief that at least some of the memory issues you are experiencing may be completely normal. In Chapter 2, we will turn to memory in older adults and examine some other memory problems that are common in healthy aging. 2. How does memory change in normal aging? After considering some of the most common ways that memory fails in healthy individuals of any age, let's now turn to some of the problems that frequently arise as one gets older. Your frontal lobes organize your memories. When we last saw Jack, whom we met in the introduction, his buddy Sam had just told him he should get his memory evaluated because Sam worried that Jack was developing Alzheimer's disease or dementia. Let's check in on Jack now. Jack's granddaughter, 11 years old and in the fifth grade, needs to do a report for social studies. The family computer isn't working, so Jack volunteers to take her to the library to show her what everyone did before computers. Jack drives her to the library. The parking lot is almost full, and they need to park in one of the furthest spots from the entrance. "I'm doing a report on continental drift," she tells Jack excitedly as they are parking and walking toward the building. "Did you know that California is going to break off and fall into the ocean one day?" She continues to chat in an unbroken stream as they walk into the library. About 30 minutes later, Jack and his granddaughter walk out of the library, book in hand. As Jack looks at the parking lot, he pauses and asks half to himself, "Now which way is the car?" Jack scans the parking lot, does not see his car, and thinks to himself, "Damn, this is one of those memory problems that Sam was talking about." "Where did we park the car?" Jack asks his granddaughter.
I don't know.
I think it was over here," she responds, pointing vaguely toward the left. Jack looks to the left and thinks, "Well, the kid doesn't know where the car is either, so maybe it's not just me. Still, I shouldn't be losing my car in the stupid parking lot." Have you ever wondered how you can keep track of all of the different memories in your head, make new ones, and recall them when you need to, at least most of the time? It is the part of your brain called the frontal lobes that helps you organize your memories. They are located, as you would expect, in the front part of your brain, just behind your forehead. The frontal lobes help you choose exactly what you are paying attention to, which, in turn, determines what you will remember. Think about all the different sights coming in from your eyes, sounds coming in from your ears, tastes and smells from your mouth and nose, and thoughts and emotions arriving from other parts of your brain. It is your frontal lobes that allow you to choose whether to pay attention to the conversation you are having with your friend or where you are parking your car. The information you are paying attention to is then transferred to the hippocampus and bound into a memory. It is also the frontal lobes that help you to search for a memory when you need it. So when you are trying to remember something, such as where you parked your car, it is the frontal lobes that are doing the trying, searching through your memories for the correct information. The frontal lobes focus attention. Is it a sign of serious memory problems if you have trouble finding your car in a parking lot? Not necessarily, particularly if you were speaking with a friend, absorbed by the conversation and not paying attention to where you parked the car. As we learned in Chapter 1, not paying attention when forming memories is one of the most common causes of not remembering something. Now we can understand a bit more of exactly what the problem is. It is your frontal lobes that are not paying attention in a situation like this one. It is also the frontal lobes that need to focus attention when attempting to retrieve a memory. Older frontal lobes need more effort to pay attention. After a bit of searching, Jack and his granddaughter find the car and start to drive home.
"Thanks so much for taking me to the library, Grandpa. I really like this book. I think it's going to be great for my social studies report."
She continues talking in a non-stop stream. Upon arriving home, she runs out of the car almost before it stopped in the driveway and then runs into the kitchen.
"Did you get a good book?" asks Sarah, her mother.
"Yes, Mom, look at this one,"
she replies, thrusting the book toward her.
"It looks great," says Sarah.
"Thanks for taking her to library, Dad.
Are you going to work on your report now?"
Sarah asks her daughter.
"If you are, you should take your Ritalin."
As we get older, our frontal lobes age along with the rest of us, and we are simply not able to pay attention as easily as we did when we were younger. We can, however, pay close attention in many settings. It just takes a bit more effort. It's sort of like our older frontal lobes have attention deficit hyperactivity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.